Here is the schematic of the internal series resistor test circuit for large capacitors. I have drawn the schematic in LTSpice. I have drawn the schematic in a little bit special way, so you'll be able to see the different connection points that is important. First, let's look at the capacitor under test. So this is the device we want to test. Inside this capacitor, there is an unknown internal series resistance, and this is what we want to measure. I've just drawn it as a separate resistor here in the schematic to visualize it a lot more, you know, easy to see. You can of course right-click on the components and input these parameters, but then it's not so visual, and I like this schematic to be visual and easy to understand. So your scope, your two scope probes, you connect as close as possible to the ground terminal of your capacitor. So that means because we want to measure the voltage drop when we are pulling a lot of current out of the capacitor. So this is the point where we measure. Also, one of your scope probes will go as close as possible to the positive terminal of your capacitor. So now you can reliably say that you're measuring the voltage on the capacitor and not including all sorts of wires and whatnot in your circuit. Your load resistor. In this circuit, I'm using 0.1 ohms. If you are measuring smaller capacitors, so if they are like a factor of 10 or even a factor of 100 smaller, of course you want to make this resistor like 1 ohms or 10 ohms, so you're not pulling too much current out of the capacitor and this way overloading it. Or, you know, you also want to make sure that you get good readings of your voltage. Also, if the capacitor is very small, and you will have to adjust the load resistor here. What I've done is I've measured from this point, the drain point of the FET. I have measured the resistor in the resistor and also the wire all the way to that point where I'm measuring, and I found 133 milliohms was my real resistance in my circuit. So of course this is the value that I need to use when I'm measuring the two different voltages. Then, you know, this voltage minus this voltage is the voltage over my 133 milliohms, and this way I find the current that I'm testing with. The unresistance in the FET is not extremely important. Of course it needs to be a lot smaller than the test current resistor. I'm using an ERF 540, and it was not in this system, so I just took another FET that had the same unresistance as the 540 FET that I was using, and I measured to be about 44 milliohms. So I just input, I just choose another FET with the same voltage rating and the same on resistance, and also about the same gate charge. So that means my simulation here will look a lot like the real world that I have on my table. The charge resistor here is also not important. I'm just using a value that is far away from the milliohms that I'm measuring. Since my pulse, the test pulse on the FET is very, very short, that means I'm not taking out a lot of energy from the capacitor. So that means the charge resistor can be very high, so it's not going to affect my measurements, because a DC supply will of course have 0 ohm output resistor resistance, so it, you know, could potentially violate this measurement. So this is why I have a high value here. It will charge this capacitor and everything will be fine. All right, so let's look at the simulation, how it's looking. So let's first verify that we have a good gate pulse. This is on purpose that I'm using really, really slow turn on and turn off times. When you are experimenting with your real circuit, you'll see why this is important. This way you are creating really nice shapes on your scopes, and it's going to be a lot easier to trigger on. Especially the turn off time in the real world, I would recommend that you make this really, really slow, maybe actually a lot slower than this. So when you're releasing all the current, because there will be inductance around in this loop, both in your test resistor and the capacitor in your wires and everything here. So when you're releasing like 60 amps or 50 amps or whatever is in your system here, all this current is going to, there will be a lot of energy stored in the inductance, and this will be released in a really bad way, and it will re-trigger your scope and all sorts of things. So just release real slow, and it's easy to do with your pulse generator. So let's look at the scope channel that is measuring the voltage over the FET. So we have the 10 volts, our DC supply is set for 10 volts, it is charging the capacitor, all is fine. So now the pulse is, all the current is going here. So what we are seeing here is actually we are emptying the capacitor. So the more capacity you have, the flatter this will be, all right? So all you need to do is put your cursors on your scope to a point just before this curve starts and just after it is flattened, like here. So the difference between this point and this point, that is the voltage we're dropping. That is the voltage that is over the internal series resistance. All right, so now we have the we can easily subtract these two, and now we have the the voltage over the internal resistance, right? So now we need to determine what is the current. Yeah, first we measured what was the resistance from this point to this point. So now we have this voltage is the voltage on this point, right? So we need to subtract this voltage, the 8.7. That is the voltage we have on this, right? So now let's look at the voltage on channel 2. And it is 2.4 volts. Okay, so the 8.7 minus 2.4, that is the voltage over this resistor. And now when you know the entire resistance, you can find the current. Of course, in a simulation program like this, it's just click on the resistor and then you have the result. But it's not like this in the real world, so this is why I'm telling you exactly how to get to the values in the real world. So now we have 62 amps, and then we have the voltage drop, and then you can calculate the internal resistance and you will get very close to the 20 milliohms of internal resistance. Of course, you can in this circuit, it's easier, it is real easy to change this internal resistance to something else, perform a new simulation, and then check that the voltage is now dropping a lot more. And then you'd redo the entire calculations again with the two different points, do the current, and then you will find that now the result is 40 milliohms. So this just proves that this circuit is actually working. Now let's try and play with this in the real world. So this is the test circuit. We are actually measuring the voltage over the load resistor from this point. This is the point where we have where we put the scope probe. So I think it's fair to say that I want to test from this point as well, right? And then I want to test to this, to the exact point here where my other probe is. Or, because the current actually goes from this screw, so shouldn't I just connect? How can I get in there and get a good connection? I can see it's the same number anyway. A little bit higher here.
A little bit lower. Okay, anyway. So this is a 100 milliohm resistor, including this piece of wire and the two solder joints and this screw on and everything here. And then my resistance is 136 milliohms. Okay, we're going to write this down. 130. Oh, it's a little bit getting lower. Why is it getting lower, huh? It's because of the temperature thing, because I just soldered. Aha, this is funny, because I soldered on this joint. And when you heat up something, it actually generates a tiny little voltage. And this is what happens. So we need to, yeah, it's actually still quite hot. Oh, this is going to trick you when you're doing milliohms of measurements. Oh, this is really funny. See, it's still falling and falling because temperature is dropping. Yeah, you see? And this is also because there are different metals in this joint. I think it's iron and copper and solder and whatnot in this joint. And when you're heating this up, you actually generate a tiny little voltage. Ah, fantastic. So now it's getting more stable. So I know it's going to go down to 113. So if we wait long enough, it's going to be that. So now we are very, very close to room temperature. I'm not going to bore you with that. I'm going to input 113 into our calculations. And now we're going to proceed. So now the circuit is actually running. On the gate, I have a signal generator generating a pulse, a very short pulse. One probe is measuring the voltage on this side of the loading resistor, and my other probe is measuring the voltage on the capacitor. I'm using different screw terminals for the current and for the loading. Both scope probes, they are on the other one. So that means I'm as close as possible to the capacitor. This way I expect to get the lowest possible internal resistance. This is my 100 ohm charge resistor. This is so high, so it's not going to affect my circuit. So I'm charging the capacitor all the time. So my pulse is running at 1 hertz. So I have a high level of 10 volt and a low level of 0 volt. My pulse width is 50 microseconds. And the rise time, so this is the gate drive rise time. And also, you have it at 1 microsecond. And my fall time is a lot slower. This is something to do with the oscillations. Because of course, I'm charging this whole system, and there is actually inductance in this, and there's also inductance inside the capacitor. So what happens every time I release the current, and if I do this really, really fast, it is going to create quite high voltages and self-oscillate a little bit. So I want to prevent that from generating high voltages and also re-triggering the scope and whatnot. So just do this real slow and you're going to have nice, nice curves. Now, let's look at the oscilloscope. So this is the voltage drop on the capacitor. I've set the point a little bit before the curve starts, or like the current pulse starts. And then after this, the inductance part of the problem. And then now we have a good steady point. If you wait until here, then this is the place where you empty the capacitor. So this will give you, of course, a wrong value. So you want to take the top point here and use this as your delta. I'm just doing it with the cursors because this is more accurate to a way to get the result. So it's 1.2, 1.3 volts. So now you can click on the cursors again, and you can go in and check the other channel. So now we're gonna go to the other channel. Of course, what you're doing here If you have both the cursor points to the top voltage, to the, this is the capacitor voltage, and this is the load resistor, this is not the way to get the correct current, because the current over the load resistor is from this point to that point, right? So you need to move one cursor to channel run and move that cursor here and move the other cursor down here. So now we can subtract these two voltages, and this will give us the load current. See, the delta between these two should be 5.5 volts over the 113 milliohm of sense resistor. So that means it is 48 amps. Our test current is 48 amps. And we took we take the maximum voltage drop on the capacitor, let's just say 1.3 volts. So 1.3 volt divided by 48 amps is 27 milliohms. So that will be the internal resistance of this big baby. Also, what you will be able to find out when you're experimenting with your the different capacitors. This one is 16, and this tiny little one is only 15. So almost double as good, this tiny one compared to the big one. They are not for the same voltage and not exactly the same. This is 12,000 and only 63 volts. So, and this is 15,000 and 100 volts, but this one is a little bit older as well. I think this one is like 15, 16 years old. So don't let you be confused about size. Size is not what matters. Real measurements and facts, this is what matters.
See, the pulses are still running, and it has been going on for quite a while. The duty cycle is 1 to 20,000. So that means this FET is ice cold. You can't feel that it's pulsing 51 amps. Nothing here gets hot.